So let's talk about arguments. No, we're not going to teach you how to win a fight. There are other channels for that kind of thing. But we can talk about the kinds of things sentences need to have inside them in order to express complete thoughts. Like the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears, a sentence can't be too big and it can't be too small. It needs to be just right. If sentences have too many or too few words in them, they don't make any sense. To make sure that the rules of our language create exactly the sentences we need them to, we need to introduce another tool into our ever-expanding kit. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
So when we first introduced the rules of syntax, we talked about the need for a system that's really flexible. After all, it has to fit with all kinds of words and sentences from all kinds of languages. The framework that we showed you to take care of this was called X-bar theory. X-bar theory gives us a general template that we can use for noun phrases, verb phrases, and everything in between. So this system is really versatile. But is it too versatile? It looks like the X-bar template is so freewheeling that it'll create all kinds of sentences that we might not want it to. So just from the theory itself, as we've talked about it so far, if we take a sentence like Goldilocks ate the porridge, there's nothing stopping us from sticking another noun phrase down there at the bottom. Why not have a sentence like Goldilocks ate the porridge the soup? Except this sentence is obviously pretty bad. It has one too many noun phrases inside of it, and it's impossible to say exactly what it means. Things don't get much better if we try pruning our tree either. Take, for example, the sentence, Goldilocks broke the chair. If we pluck out the chair, we still get something that fits our X-bar template. The problem is that Goldilocks broke barely qualifies as English, unless Goldilocks is an inanimate object. Or unless she's playing pool. Language can get kind of weird at the edges. So how do we make sure that the way we formulate our rules doesn't allow for sentences that are so full of porridge and soup that they can't even get out of bed? Or sentences that are over so quickly that you can't find out how the story ends? Well, we'll need to add something to our recipe that makes sure that we only get what we want, no more and no less. Based on the examples that we just talked about, you might think that we could just invent some rule that would say, make sure that every verb has only one noun phrase after it. After all, that would filter out the bad sentences that we've seen so far. But unfortunately, that's a bit too strict. It might work for sentences with verbs like eat or break, but it wouldn't really work for ones with verbs like sleep. Not only are we allowed to say Goldilocks is sleeping, if we try to add another noun phrase like the bed, we're back to square one, a sentence that fits our template but that just has no business at all calling itself English. It seems like what pieces we want and don't want in our sentences depends on what words we start out with. Verbs usually drive the sentential action, and like porridge, they come in a few different flavors. Some verbs, like eat and break, get really lonely unless they're in the nurturing presence of a noun phrase. Then we have verbs that are like real party animals, like give and put, who aren't happy unless they have a couple of friends around. And then there are verbs that are so greedy, like know and believe, that they're not happy unless you give them a whole other sentence. We already know that speakers of a language have to pair up each word they have with some meaning, so it's not too much of a stretch to suppose that they have to also keep track of what should show up alongside a verb. You need to make sure that every word in your sentence is blissfully content and doing what it's supposed to. Speakers just have to remember what a verb needs in order to form a complete sentence and feel satisfied with its lot in life. Each of these phrases is called an argument. Arguments come after verbs, but before them too. A word like eat needs two arguments, specifically two noun phrases, because there needs to be something that gets eaten and someone to do the eating. Sleep only gets one, a noun phrase corresponding to the sleeper. But something like put gets three, two noun phrases and a prepositional phrase corresponding to the putter, the thing that gets put, and where the thing is put. So like, the bears put the porridge on the table. Now okay, so this looks great, but wait, you think. Just saying that eat needs two noun phrases isn't exactly right. Can you really say, the porridge ate Goldilocks? Not unless it's some horrible monster gruel that's come to turn this story on its head. Or okay, sleep needs one NP, so why does the bed slept not make any sense? As it happens, the possibility of sentences that fit our templates but don't mean anything was noticed as far back as the mid-1950s by Noam Chomsky. He showed that something could be totally okay in terms of syntax, but just make no sense. That's what's behind maybe the most famous example sentence in all of linguistics, colorless green ideas sleep furiously. So we need to go one step further. Verbs can't just look for any random version of a phrase to fill in their argument structure. They have certain roles that need to be filled. Linguists call these theta roles, and they describe the function and meaning of the phrase in the sentence. So you have rules like agent for arguments that perform some kind of action, or experiencer for ones that experience some state or emotion. They can also be things like theme for arguments that undergo some action, or goal for the endpoint of a journey. So tying it all together, we can say that a verb like eat has two arguments, one agent for doing the eating and one theme for getting eaten. A verb like give looks for three, a giving agent, a goal to give the gift to, and a theme gift. We're also left with a nice way to explain why some verbs are content with just one argument, while others are more happy with two or three. It isn't totally arbitrary, like, this verb needs two noun phrases in a prepositional phrase because grammar. Instead, we've made a deep connection between the meaning of a verb and the kind of sentence it appears in. A verb like eat represents an action that really needs both an agent, the eater, and the theme, something that gets eaten. Eating just can't happen without both of them. And this fact is encoded in our mental representation of the verbs themselves. That's how we can make sure that the verbs get exactly what they need, no more and no less. Verbs swagger into a sentence looking for a certain number of theta roles, and each one's got to be filled by one and only one argument. And you can't have arguments just floating around without any theta roles to fill. These two conditions put together make up what we call the theta criterion. And with that in place, we don't need to worry about crazy sentences sneaking into our language while nobody's home. So, we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you got out of the house before the bears got home, you learned that X-bar theory is a very flexible system that generates far more sentences than we need it to. That verbs need a specific number of arguments to make sense. That these arguments can't just be any old phrase, they need to fill some theta role. And that the theta criterion makes sure that every sentence contains the exact right number of arguments. The Ling space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman, and directed by Delélise Prévost. This week's episode was written by Stéphane Hurtubise. Our production assistants are him and Georges Coulomb. Our music and sound design is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, where you can bring the discussion back over to our website, where we'll have some extra materials on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Hengap Lanye.